Well, God is in the business of doing new things. And it says in his word in Isaiah 43 that I am doing a new thing. And now it springs forth. Do you see it? And certainly God is doing a new thing in our world. And he's actually doing a new thing in the church. And all around the world today, church is different. But the Spirit of God is still going to go forth, and the Word of God is going to go forth, and the worship of God is going to continue to go forth, and I'm so glad to be with you now. Welcome to everyone who's sitting in living rooms, that may be at coffee shops, maybe you're on your phone. Wherever you are, welcome. We're really glad you're here. I also want to personally welcome a couple of friends I've asked to join us. You know who you are. Thanks for watching. Really, really excited to be with you. But I just want to be clear, and you may know this, but the church is the church when people gather in his name, wherever they gather in his name. Amen. And so wherever you are, trust me, as it says in Matthew 18, verse 20, Jesus says, where two or three are gathered, there so am I. So it's not just where the people gather, but Jesus gathers wherever two or three people gather. And so it's got to be pretty cool to be there knowing that Jesus is with you wherever you're at as well. So be encouraged by that. It's an amazing truth. Well, what is happening in our world? It's crazy. The world and the world system has been brought to its knees pretty quickly. And we've all been experiencing it. Literally every hour, we get new news reports that can shake us, that can confuse us, that maybe anger us, and that certainly trouble us. And everybody's kind of experiencing it right now in different ways, right? Like, you know, some people are very, very concerned about the actual spread of the virus. They're concerned for their own health, or they're concerned for the health of their loved ones. And that certainly is right and good, because it's real. But then some of us maybe are on a different extreme where we're like upset or concerned or troubled by society's reactions and what you might deem as overreactions, and that's causing you to maybe be troubled or to be concerned. But regardless of the state of how you are experiencing it and how you view it, the reality is that there's facets of what's going on right now in our world that are going to cause all of us to have some troubles. And today we are going to be in a passage of scripture in John 14. So if you got your Bibles, you can open it up. We're going to be in John 14, and we're going to see that the disciples are experiencing something that is causing their hearts to be troubled, similar to what we might be experiencing today. And what we're going to see is that Jesus understands, Jesus knows, and Jesus has compassion and love towards them and shares some words to them that give them hope in the midst of their troubles. And so what we're just going to do today is we're going to look at Jesus' words, and I pray that the words that he spoke to them about 2,000 years ago are going to speak to you and to me and to all of us here in the same way. And so I pray that his words will bring hope and clarity in the midst of some trouble and confusion. And so as we get ready to get into the word, just join me and let's pray, and then we'll get going. Father, I am so blessed because you have given us such clear love and words as it relates to troubling times. God, what a privilege it is, what a miracle it is that 2,000 years ago, a group of men gathered and were troubled in their hearts, and Jesus spoke to them, and you allowed one of the guys in the room by your Spirit to write down what he said. And while it maybe was still confusing to them, we're thankful that we have the ability now to look back and see the blessing that are in these words. And God, I pray that you would use these words to bless me and to bless everyone who's listening, God, in the way that you intended these words to do it. So God, meet us now. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we're going to be in John 14, and just want to give you the context so you understand where we're going to be and why this is important. So first of all, this is important because this is the night, this is Thursday night before Jesus is going to his death. It's the Thursday night before Good Friday. A lot of things happened this night, all right? It's a big night in the Word of God. A lot of John, four chapters are recorded what happens this night. So this is happening in the upper room. Jesus has gathered his disciples. It's Passover. They're having a Passover meal. And he does something at the beginning. He grabs a basin of water and a towel, and he washes the disciples' feet, giving the disciples a great example of love and service. And that's a great example to us in this time, how we can be serving others in the midst of everyone, what everyone's dealing with. There's communion. He institutes the first communion. He takes a cup, and he takes bread, and he breaks it, and he tells them that it was his body. This is his body, and this is his blood, and he shares it with the men at the table. But then he says something that really begins the trouble in the hearts of the disciples. He tells them that he's leaving. He tells the disciples he's leaving, and where he's going, they're not going to be able to follow. And the disciples are confused. They've traveled with him for over 2 years, and they've watched him raise the dead and give sight to the blind, and now he's going to leave them. And they don't understand, and so they're troubled. And the famous story of Peter saying, well, I'll follow you wherever you go, God, and I'll go to the death. And you may know the story. Jesus tells Peter that before the cock crows, he's going to deny him 3 times. And so the disciples are confused now. They're fearful, and they're troubled. And that brings us to the passage, John 14, verse 1. Look at your Bibles. Jesus says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. The first point today is this, troubled question mark, believe. Jesus is your answer. Troubled, believe. Jesus is your answer. The first thing I want you to note is how Jesus perceives and understands that the disciples were troubled. That is such a blessing to us. He knows. He is all-knowing. We'll talk about that in a little bit. He's all-knowing, and he understands that the disciples are hurting, and he cares about their troubles. This doesn't seem amazingly awesome because we know the heart of Jesus, but if you put it in context to what's happening, in an hour, about maybe a little longer, he's going to be betrayed. He knows what's coming. It says other place in the scripture in a little bit, he's going to be in agony over the reality of what's happening. But yet, he perceives the heavy heart of the disciples and is going to minister to them in the midst of his own struggle and pain. It's beautiful. And what does he say? He says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Jesus says the answer to your troubles is to believe. It's to believe. Well, that's pretty broad. Believe in what? What does he mean when he says believe? He's saying believe in who I am. Jesus is saying, do you understand and believe in all the things I claim to be? Do you believe in all of the claims that I've made to you about who I am? And if you do, that will bring calm and peace to your soul. So he says the answer to their troubles is to believe. I don't understand why the Lord has allowed the coronavirus to bring the world to its knees. I just don't understand. I don't understand exactly what he's doing. I don't know why. I wish I could tell you why. I'd be an amazing pastor if I could understand the heart of God and tell you today exactly why God has allowed it to happen. His ways are higher than our ways, right? We just don't understand. But I can tell you this, knowing and believing in the character of God gives me the calm that I'm looking for. That's what Jesus is teaching us here. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Meditating on Jesus' attributes is both a powerful act of my worship and a powerful weapon for my worry. Let me say that again. Meditating on Jesus' attributes is both a powerful act of my worship, but it's also a powerful weapon for my worry. Believing helps us in the midst of our trouble. I got my prayer journal here. You can zoom in on this. It's called A Diary of Private Prayer by John Bailey. Get close. Yeah, get close, because this, it's hard to find. It's out of print, this one. This is the old English version. You can get the new English version. But this is my prayer journal. The reason I want to share with the prayer journal is that I pray for myself. I pray for one of my kids every day and my wife every day. I pray for you all. I pray for the church every day, various things. Then I pray for people that I hope come to know Jesus Christ. But before I do all of that, I start praying prayers about God's attributes. I meditate on God's attributes. I'm looking at it. This was March 3rd, sovereignty and love. This is July 3rd, providence and kindness. Prayed for his justice on August 3rd. These, they go by day. Here I prayed for his sovereignty. I prayed for his holiness. I prayed for his faithfulness. I prayed for his power. I start out my prayers with attributes of God. Why? Because in the midst of all the things that we go through in life, when we focus on what is true about our Savior, it gives us the calm and the peace that we need. So I just want to share with you five truths for your troubles. We're going to quickly walk. These are five of the attributes that directly relate to calming your heart in the midst of the troubles. You can see them here on the screen. Here's the first one. Jesus is all-knowing. We just talked about it. Jesus knows. You have to know when you're hurting, he is aware. Secondly, he doesn't just know, he is all-loving. Jesus is all-loving. It says a definition, 1 John, it says that God is love. It says in 1 Peter 5 that we should cast all our cares on him because he cares for you. He loves you. He loves you perfectly. He's not just all-knowing. He's not just all-loving. Look at this. Jesus is all-controlling. It kind of sounds bad, like he's this control freak. No, God is in control, and he's bringing about his purposes. And when you understand that, it brings the peace that you're searching for. God is in complete control. It's called his sovereignty. Next, he's not just knowing, loving, and controlling. He's also, Jesus is all-powerful. He can do whatever he chooses to do. He says, right, the verse there, Jeremiah 32, 27, he says, I am the God of all flesh. Is anything too hard for me? And what's the answer? No. The answer is no. And then lastly, Jesus is all good. Everything he does is good. All right? And you combine these five facets about who God is, and you believe in the truth about who he says he is, that is going to give you what Jesus wants you to have in the midst of your troubles. When I pray for people, when they come to me in their struggles, I pray these attributes over them to help them to claim it to God. Like, he doesn't need to be reminded, but I just remind myself and the person I'm praying with. We pray through these attributes because it gives them hope and it gives them help in the midst of their troubles. 2019, for me, was a crazy year. It was a crazy year for our church. I couldn't believe some of the things I was dealing with. I got into ministry to talk about Jesus and pray, and I'm talking about things I never thought I'd talk about, and it was overwhelming, and there was cause for trouble. But I'm telling you, the attributes of God gave me what I needed, and he'll give that to you too. But I want you to also know that life is filled with confusion and stress and grief and trials and testing and troubles. And though today all of us are united in the reality of us dealing with the troubles of what's happening in our world because of this virus, you also have your own personal troubles that you bring into this church today, wherever you are. You have your own personal troubles. Maybe it's a health issue. You maybe got some news, or maybe it's a financial issue and you're worried about getting overwhelmed and sunk financially, or maybe it's a stronghold of an addiction. Or maybe it's a relational struggle with someone in your family. Maybe it's a prodigal. I don't know what your trouble is. We all have different troubles personally today. And while they're all different, the answer to them is all the same. It's to believe Jesus is the answer. So that's our point number one. Here's our point number two. Troubled, hope. Jesus is coming for you. Troubled, hope. Jesus is coming for you. Let's go to the scriptures, verse 2. In my Father's house are many rooms, Jesus says. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Wow. Exciting. This is exciting. I can't wait to talk about this. Jesus gives the disciples and us a second way that we can get help in the midst of our troubles. What he does here, he's giving the disciples hope for their future. Hope for their future. Look at the scriptures. In my Father's house are many rooms. He lets them know that there's room, that he has many rooms. If they were worried if they were going to make it there, if there's not a place, he's saying that there's many rooms. And then he says he's going to prepare a place. And I don't know, we don't really understand exactly what all this entails, but I'm telling you, it sounds awesome that Jesus Christ would choose to leave me but go and prepare a place for me is unbelievable. It's such an amazing thought that he cared about each one of these guys. And Jesus cares for each one of us. And for us that understand Jesus and have accepted Jesus Christ by faith, he's preparing a place for us. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know if it's a bungalow. I don't know what it is. But it's awesome that Jesus is preparing a place. But the one thing I want to really focus on is what he says now. He says, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. You see, Jesus loves relationship. From the beginning in the Garden of Eden, he created man and woman so he could be together with them. Jesus left heaven and came to earth so he could be together with them. And he left so he could prepare a place so one day we could be together with him again. And he's trying to bring hope to the disciples in the midst of their troubles because they're confused and they're scared and fearful that he's leaving. And Jesus is basically saying, it's not goodbye. It's just, I'll see you soon. How amazing. In the midst of their troubles and fears, Jesus gives them a vision of the future that inspires hope by saying, have hope, guys. I'm coming for you. When your heart is heavy and it's hard to hold on, fix your eyes on heaven for a filling of encouraging hope. That's what Jesus is teaching us. When your heart is heavy and it's hard to hold on, fix your eyes on heaven for a filling of encouraging hope because Jesus is coming. All the disciples were Jewish. And so when Jesus talks about that he's in my Father's house has many rooms and I'm going to leave and prepare a place for you and then I'm going to come again and take you to where I am also, the disciples being Jewish would have thought that that reminded them a lot about a Jewish wedding, how Jewish wedding occurs. Maybe not all of them, but I bet some of them, like, gosh, that's kind of strange because it sounds like what happens in a wedding. And let me explain it to you, and I think it really helps understand what Jesus is saying here. In ancient Jewish weddings, when a young man and a young woman would maybe be arranged by the parents or a man would have an eye on a girl, he would have to go to the would-be bride's father. And he would have to pay a dowry, the price for marrying her. Ultimately, that ends up going to the bride. She kind of gets it back. It went to the dad, but then the dad would give it to the bride to get things ready for her wedding and all that. But he has to pay for the rights to marry his daughter. Once he gets the right to marry the daughter, they do what's called a wine ceremony. I got a couple pictures of it. And the wine ceremony is when a groom takes a cup of wine, the would-be groom, and he takes a drink of it, and then he offers it to the girl. And then if the girl drinks of it, it begins the betrothal process. It's very interesting because earlier in the evening, Jesus took a cup and he took a drink of it and he gave it to all his disciples. And now he's kind of kind of intimating that this is similar to what's happening in a wedding, this whole going away. I'll tell you more about it. Just stick with me. So once they both take a drink of the cup, they are agreed to be betrothed. All right? In Jewish times, back in ancient Jewish times, the betrothal time was about a year. And so what would happen is now the groom, after they've been betrothed, there's a ceremony, he goes back to his father's house. While he's back at his father's house, the bride-to-be now she uses the dowry and buys the finest linen she can get because she's going to start weaving her wedding dress together. She gets the family jewels that have been passed down for generations, and she starts weaving them into a tiara she's going to put on her head to be as beautiful as she can be for her groom. She works diligently. She probably is cutting weight, right? Because you got to get ready for your wedding. She's trying to have a good diet. And she's getting ready because she is going to be excited in about a year's time. She doesn't know the day, but she knows sometime in the future she's going to be married to that guy. Over here, the groom has gone back to his father's house. And have you ever heard of a chuppah? Anybody been to a Jewish wedding, the chuppah? Well, that's a picture, actually, of what really used to happen in Jewish days was the groom, would-be groom, builds a room adjacent to his father's house, like an addition to his father's house, an actual room. And he uses his best craftsmanship, and he decorates it, and in the middle of the room, he puts a bed. And that's going to be for him and his bride. He actually builds a house adjacent to his father's house. In about a year's time, she's told to be ready. She's got to have her lamp ready because Jewish customs is the groom will come in the middle of the night, but she doesn't know the day, so her and all of her virgins have to have the lamp ready because they don't know the day, and they have to get up, and they better have oil ready because it's going to come in the middle of the night. The day comes. The evening comes, and the groom gets his family and all of his groomsmen, and they bring musical instruments, and they start going across town. I'm coming, honey, boom, boom, boom. Wake up the whole town, because I'm coming for my bride. She quick gets her light on. She puts her dress on, but he's coming. He's coming for me. And he comes across town, and he grabs hold of his bride, and they parade back all across town again. And they have a huge wedding banquet, and everybody celebrates. And at the end of the evening, he takes his wife, and he goes into the room adjacent to his father's house, and they consummate the marriage, and they're wed now for all time. In my father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again, and I'm going to take you to where I am, so that where I am, you will be also. That is the picture of Jesus Christ that gives you hope in the midst of the troubles. You look to the future. He's coming for you. Jesus Christ coming for me. I'm his bride. It's unbelievable. It's amazing. It's phenomenal. It should just obliterate our troubles looking to the future. It's encouraging. I have MS, and I am so looking forward to the day that Jesus comes and takes me. My whole left side doesn't work. Some of you know the story, but I'm struggling with it. My hand doesn't work very good. But I know when Jesus comes, I'm going to get a heavenly body. And he's going to take me to where I am, and I'm going to be new. And I'm going to be different. And it's fun. We all get to dream about what heaven's like. We get a picture in the scriptures, but I have my own dreams about what heaven is going to be like. And I am hoping that everybody is age 30, like in our prime. I just hope for that. It'd be super fun. So we'd all be the same age. We'd all be like what we believe is our best selves. Then one of the reasons I like that, and I also believe that I dream that in heaven, we get to do things that we like to do. And I want to play basketball. And I cannot wait to challenge my son, Michael, in basketball. He's a good basketball player, okay? But I've been watching him his whole life. And I know his weaknesses. And if I'm 30, he doesn't believe it, but I'm telling you, I got this little jump hook. He cannot stop it. But I can't do that now, right? But I'm looking forward to that day so much that it gives me hope when I have the hard times of my day. When I'm having a hard time buttoning in my shirts, I think about I'm not always going to be like this because Jesus is what? Coming for me. Like a bride waiting for her groom, are you awaiting Jesus coming for you with giddy anticipation? If so, is your anticipation showing up in your preparedness? How are you getting ready? I mentioned the bride cutting weight. Well, that's kind of a joke, but the reality is as we get ready, what are we cutting out of our lives? Maybe it's a sinful attitude, or maybe it's a sinful habit or a sinful action. What are we cutting out to make ourselves ready, to make our dress more fine and white for the day that he comes? On the flip side, what are we sewing? What kind of diamonds or jewels are we sewing into our tiara? Maybe sewing in things like kindness and humility and gentleness, the things that we can do that ultimately will take off our tiara and lay at Jesus' feet because it's all his anyway. But what are we doing to sow righteousness into our lives to get ready for Jesus coming? Let me give you a couple of suggestions as practical as we can be. As it relates to this season with the coronavirus, I want to talk to our older people. I'd love you to sow in to your tiara the character trait of humility. I want you to ask for help if you need it from neighbors, but certainly from our church. You guys might be home. I don't know what you choose to do. It's not your own decisions. If you don't want to come out of your home, whatever. But if you need help, we're here to help. And so sow in humility so we can help you. I want to talk to other people who have time. Maybe you aren't working. Maybe your work is closed. You have time. How are you going to meet a need in this time to sow in kindness and to sow in service? Maybe you can bring toilet paper to your neighbors. This whole toilet paper thing is crazy. We're going to start using that as currency, I think. How much is that pack of gum? 15 sheets. Okay. How about praying for a need? Just praying for people's needs in this time. That's going to sow some jewels in your tiara. Invite a friend to your house to watch the service next Sunday. Have a brunch. These are just jewels. I want to be bedazzled for Jesus, and I hope you do too. Amen. Just real quickly, Revelation 19, and we'll tie it all together. If you want to flip over there, Revelation 19, verse 7. 7 and 8. Look at this. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory. Verse 7 of Revelation 19. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. Our hope abounds. Our hope abounds as we activate our anticipation for the coming of our groom. It's not just in looking forward, which is definitely what Jesus wants to do, but he also wants us to activate our anticipation by doing things and loving people and being ready, getting ourselves ready for his return. So our second point is troubled hope. Jesus is coming for you. And the last point is troubled. Trust. Jesus is all you need. Flip back to John 14, verse 4. And you know the way to where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Verse 4, you know the way to where I'm going, but Thomas, we love Thomas. Thomas, we should all love the disciple Thomas. What's his nickname? Doubting Thomas, and he proves his character right here. He asks an amazing question. And some of you listening, and maybe some of you in the room, You might be asking the same question today. How can we know the way? So thankful for this question being in the Bible, so Jesus could answer it so clearly and so plainly. Jesus is all you need, and he tells us how and why. He says, I am the way. The way is not good person path. You can't get to heaven by doing good things. We've all done things that dishonor the Lord, and one sin. If you keep the whole law but stumble on one point, you're guilty of all, and we're all guilty. And nothing in heaven can be in heaven unless it's perfectly spotless and clean, and we're all guilty. You can't do enough good things to overcome it. But Jesus is the way. It's not good person path. It's not higher power highway. There isn't just this something thing out there that if we all just kind of believe in something more than ourselves, it's all going to lead to heaven. The answer is no. It's not Atheist Avenue. All streets do not lead to heaven. There's only one street that leads to heaven, and its name is Jesus. But while it's very exclusive, it's available to all. No matter who you are or no matter what you've done, Jesus Christ is calling you to drink of the cup, to say yes to him, believe who he is, and you can have what he offers. But Jesus is the way. Next he says, I am the truth. Jesus is the author of truth. He's the author of truth. He's not just true. He's the anything that is true is of Jesus. And the promises of the world, they don't deliver. They don't. They will fail you. Your bank account will fail you. Your spouse will fail you. He or she is not perfect. Don't put your hopes in them. Your boss isn't perfect. Your pastor isn't perfect. I may let you down. Our staff might let you down. The economy certainly can let you down. The politicians, our lifestyle, our way of life, it didn't take long. It took 6 weeks for our lifestyle to be completely altered. You can't put your faith in your lifestyle. But Jesus can be trusted because he's trustworthy. Every single word in this book is true, and you can count on it. You can take that to the bank. He's watching Jeremiah chapter 1 says he's watching over his word to perform it. When he utters it, it's already true, but he just to make sure you understand it, he's watching what he said to make sure that he does it. And so he's all you need. Don't put your faith in other things. Trust in Jesus because he is the truth. And then lastly, he says, I am the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. He's life. We already talked about him being eternal life. For those of you that have accepted Jesus Christ and understand who he is and believe that he died for you, you have eternal life. For those of you that don't know, I would love it for you to make that decision today. But he is the life. But while he's eternal life, Jesus is also life for here and now. He's a life in heaven forever, but he's also abundant life here and now. Jesus said in John 10:10, I've come that you may have life and have it abundantly. He wants you to have overcoming life now. You want more abundant life tomorrow? Get more of Jesus today. And we will live with joy and peace and hope that God promises and he does not fail. Let not your hearts be troubled, Harvest Bible Chapel, anyone listening in. We need to believe. We need to have hope. And we need to trust. I pray that the words that Jesus spoke to disciples 2,000 years ago is spoken to you today in a real way, in a clear way. And his encouragement to believe and to hope and to trust will calm your troubled heart. But not just for today and not just for this season, but for the rest of your life till Jesus comes for you and brings you home. Let not your hearts be troubled. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you have given us your word so clearly to us, so plainly, and you don't want our hearts to be troubled. And so, God, help us. Help us to hold fast to these things, to believe in you, to hope in you, to trust in you. And, oh God, we realize you're doing a new thing. You're doing a new thing in our world. You're doing a new thing in your church. And, oh God, I pray that you would do a new thing in every heart that is listening to this right now, God. You know what we need, and you're willing to give it. So thank you for that promise, for your glory only. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ.